So, Professor, if we're going to say, hey, we're not rejecting reductionism entirely, it's a valuable tool, we understand biological mechanisms.
No, not at all. You need reductionism as well.
If we're going to say that, and then at the same time we need a holistic perspective to understand how those mechanisms interact and give rise to emergent properties, etc., then is that a dualistic view where the wholes and the parts exist as separate entities?
Okay, right. A form of dualism. Yes, I like that question very much. I could go on for ages about dualism, but I will try and be brief. In one sense, yes, because what we're saying is reductionism alone is not enough to describe a system that is functional. You need the constraints which form the boundary conditions for the behavior of the molecular components. That much is very obvious. I don't know whether one really wants to call that dualism. I mean, here we come to the history of dualistic interpretations of life. And of course, inevitably, we're back to Descartes and his, what I regard as the huge mistake of thinking that he had to invent some ghostly thing here that interacts with the brain. I don't think we need that at all. What it seems to me is the deep issue here is, I think the question you're asking, does a form of dualism come back in the sense that there's an interaction between the whole and its parts? Well, if you want to say that is true, I don't think I'd want necessarily to disagree with you, because saying it that way, that the whole is constraining the parts, gets the point I'm making about biological relativity and there being no privileged level of organization for causation. But this is not dualism in the sense of postulating a very different kind of thing from the physical structure that we know, because what is forming that structure is itself the molecules that form the thing.
Right.
So I'm not sure that it's certainly not bringing dualism back in the sense that Descartes was using that word. And I think, therefore, we need to tread very carefully here. The trouble is that dualism has a philosophical history to it too, doesn't it? It isn't, as it were, free to suddenly make up in a different way. I suppose what I'm saying is I'm a little unhappy with the idea that because we need an interaction between the whole and the parts, that we're bringing back a form of dualism. We're not bringing back a form of dualism in the sense that Descartes meant. That much, I think, is clear.
So if it's the case, then, that the whole is made up of the parts, and so they're a part of the same underlying substance, so we don't have a dualism in terms of substance.
Whole is made up of the parts. Absolutely right. Yeah.
Is that not then a statement of reductionism? Let me just be clear. There's a couple of different kinds of reductionism. So there's an ontological reductionism, which will state that all of the entities at some higher level are made up of the entities at a lower level. And then there's a theoretical reductionism, which says you can't make sense of, say, a financial system in terms of electrons because they're at different levels.
No, indeed. No, I understand. No, the problem with reductionism applied to biology is that it's much more plausible to think that a biological system is just its molecules than to think that a banking system is just the molecules of which the buildings and computers that the banking system uses consist. Absolutely right. Yes, the problem with reductionism in relation to biology is how far it is taken. taken to the extent of saying that, well, if we knew enough about all the molecules, we could predict exactly what will happen. I would say you'd probably need to build a computer out of more than the solar system to enable you to do that.
Oh, okay. I misspoke then when I said there are two types of reductionism. There are at least three types. So there's the ontological reductionism, then there's the theoretical, and then there's the epistemic reductionism, which says that we can't, in practice, predict.
Exactly so.
So are you saying that epistemic reductionism is incorrect, but ontological reductionism is correct?
Well, it might be, but then we need to ask a deeper question, don't we then? Is the universe an open system or not?
Hmm.
So you can't be reductionist about an open system. And I don't think we know the answer to that question.
Interesting.
Very important. If the universe is an open system, meaning there is no limit, we can just go on finding more and more stuff, more and more things, then I don't know what the difference between ontological and epistemological reductionism would amount to. If the universe is a closed system, then I suppose in some sense it must be possible to imagine computing it and being able to predict its future behavior to any degree of accuracy. Whether you'd need more material to make the computers to do that than the universe itself contains, I don't know the answer to that question. I strongly suspect that may be true, because combinatorial explosion in biology is a phenomenal problem. Just take 20,000 genes, about the number we think we've got of real protein-making DNA in our genomes. I once did a calculation about 20 years ago now, how many combinations of those functions could there be? It turns out to be a number approximately 10 to the 70,000. There are only 10 to the 80 or 82, depends on your view of the universe, particles in the whole universe. So it's easy to show that the possible combinations, functional combinations that could occur even just between 20,000 genes, let alone all the other processes, epigenetic and so on, that occur in living organisms, means that you've got a combinatorial explosion problem way beyond anything we can cope with. So I think it's in my view, very unlikely that the difference between ontological and epistemological will ever matter to us. That, I think, is what I draw as a conclusion from this part of our discussion. It is as though we're epistemologically restricted in knowing whether the ontological possibility can even exist.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's a funny way of trying to put it, but I think it's the best I can do.
Directly after this podcast, I emailed Dennis because I had a question about the open nature of the universe. I'll read it, and then I'll read his comments. Dear Dennis, in our podcast, you posited that the universe may be an open system. However, this prompts the question, what exactly is the universe open to? We need to clarify what's meant by the quote-unquote universe. If we're referring to the observable universe as an open system, then that's a more straightforward assertion. However, if we consider the universe with the capital U as the totality of all that exists, then this claim becomes less clear. The universe with a capital U, defined as the collection of everything that exists, which could also be considered reality, if we were to discover something external to our current understanding of the lowercase u universe, we would naturally incorporate it into this larger framework, thereby expanding our conception of the capital U universe. So given this definition, one could argue that the capital U universe is a necessarily closed system. If there is something beyond or interacting with what we currently define as the universe, then it implies that our initial definition is incomplete. We would then revise our understanding to include whatever this new component is thus maintaining that the capital U universe, by its definition, encompasses everything, all that there is, and interacts with nothing outside itself. In other words, if there's something outside it, you just include that into the universe. What are your thoughts on this argument? Does it hold that the universe must be closed because any external interaction would simply expand our definition of what constitutes the universe, revealing our previous concept as impoverished? Dennis writes, and I have permission to use AI with his voice.
Dear Curt, good question. I think it will all depend on what metaphysical stance we adopt. If we think that the universe may be infinite, then anything we see will be open to everything we cannot see, even though that may be infinite. Of course, people may prefer a finite universe, as with the current model. I can't see how we can, with our present knowledge, know which metaphysical view is correct. I incline towards the view that the current model is deficient. Too many arbitrary and very precise constants. As a modeler myself, that makes me suspicious. Best wishes.
If you enjoyed this toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. Don't forget to follow Theories of Everything with Curt Jaimungal on Spotify for exclusive content and in-depth discussions. Your support on Spotify helps us grow and to reach more curious minds like yours. Check out the link in the description and join the Core Toe community on Spotify today. See you there.